Digital history is, to me, anything that we can represent in bits and bytes, I guess. I think I would take the broad definition. So it's census databases, it's scanned documents, it's something on the internet, it's something on CD-ROM, it's 3D reconstructions, it's gaming sometimes. That's all to me. I think our audience for traditional research is small and dwindling. I think, who reads our professionally written scholarly books, unless you're an exceptional writer, and there are those in the field, it's only other scholars. And some of them will then write something more popular, which gets out to a public audience, but even then the number of readers we know is declining. People are spending more time, I don't know if it's true in the States, but I've seen statistics lately, more time in front of the internet than they are on TV, which used to be our main competitor. So I don't think there is much of an audience except for specialists for the print media anymore. I think the book is an important media and allows us to argue certain long and complicated arguments in ways that the new media doesn't. But to reach the public, to reach students, to reach young people, to reach any audience that's actually growing rather than shrinking, I think we have to move into the digital world. I was accidental. I was working with a friend and now colleague, Ruth Sandwell. We are both graduate students. And we hit across this mystery in our archival research. Ruth found it. A black man was murdered by, we don't know who killed William Robinson, but a Native man, a Native American man, was charged and convicted and hanged. And we looked at the case quite closely and found that the evidence was flimsy. There was an alibi that was disregarded, that it could easily have been a miscarriage of justice, likely was. So we did that as a document set, as a conference presentation. We'd been given the task to come up with some alternate way of presenting our research, but not talking head, kind of. So we had a bit like a murder mystery game that you go for dinner, the murder mystery dinners you sometimes. And that worked really well, and then we used it in classrooms. And then we thought, well, we can even complicate this more with this new technology, because then in 1997, the web was new. We could increase the number of documents that we have available. So with very rudimentary skills and no money, we built our first website. And we found then that by accident, we had found this convergence of the new technology, new ways of thinking about history, looking at small stories like William Robinson and tying them to bigger themes, kind of the postmodern scholarship, which says not everything has to be kind of the grand narrative that, nation building, that there are other things going on underneath that we should be interested in. It all came together sort of by accident with William Robinson, and once it was online, people were interested, and that got us following up. Each one would be different, I would say. The internet, for example, allows us to be interactive with our audience in a way that we've never been able to be before. The 3D simulations, and we're only getting started in that technology, but would allow students, I think the hardest thing to teach historically is the ability to get inside somebody else's head and understand that they viewed the world in a different way. It's cross-cultural, cross-temporal understanding. Imagine being put into a 3D world where you behave as a 2006 North American, but you're in Salem, Massachusetts, in the 17th century. You wouldn't last long. You'd be burned at the stake. So very quickly, you've got to learn the codes and the behavior and how people think in order to survive in that virtual world. The GIS, another thing, again, allows us to see history laid out in space and ask questions about, well, maybe we know of Chinatown, but maybe it wasn't only Chinese who lived in Chinatown. Maybe it was only 70% Chinese. Maybe it was only 50% Chinese. In Victoria's Chinatown now, where I come from, only 10% of the population is Chinese. But in the 19th century, if it was only 30%, and we can only know this by mapping it and GIS and census, did people live side by side, the non-Chinese? They lived together in the same house. I mean, it's only with the new technologies that we can really answer those kinds of questions. So every technology opens up a new box, and of course every technology closes doors too. I mean, they're each a lens that allows us some insights that we don't get from the others. I think in the future we will deliver most of our history digitally. I think I already see this now, that even the journal articles we read tend to be the ones that are already digitized and online, which is a shame in many ways, because there's a whole corpus of literature that may never be digitized that will become kind of like dark ages, because they'll be lost to future scholarship in the way that they'd be so hard to find. So I think in the future we'll transmit most of our knowledge, we'll research our knowledge. It'll bring a convergence of research and teaching, I think, in the sense that the databases that we build our research on, that we write our books or our cyber articles out of, will all be available. I think, too, that inevitably we're going to experiment, and hopefully successfully, but it's an experiment with gaming technology, simulations, that we know it engages. People can be addictive, even. There's a fascination for historical games, civilizations and empires, and building sort of simulated cities, Sim City, that kind of stuff. Why not teach people while they are engaging in activities that they find enjoyable?